first, I'm sorry, I should say, the first case that I worked on in collaboration with the FBI was the Moores Ford lynching case that took place in Monroe, Georgia. And what an amazing case. For your listeners, it was the murder of two young African-American couples, George and May Murray Darcy and Roger and Dorothy Malcolm. I think one of the most captivating things about the case was that it was one of the last known public lynchings in America at that time. And so that's how I was introduced to the Moores Ford lynching case.
Mm. Just for listeners, just really drive home the heinousness of this act. Dorothy Malcolm was reportedly 7 months pregnant at the time of this slaughter act of white terrorism. When you were going out to get this information, were you talking to black people, white people, both?
I was actually talking to both. The most amazing thing, there was a young activist, I shouldn't say young activist, but an elder activist who reached out to me and gave me a lot of information on the Moores Ford lynching case. This case really didn't have to, you really didn't have to investigate these cases because people in the community kind of knew the mob who was involved with the murder itself and those who were still alive. So you also had the Moores Ford Committee, which is was a committee formed, an interracial committee that was formed by people in the community who wanted to solve the crime itself and also reconcile the murder with the family. In terms of racial reconciliation, I'm sorry. So this wasn't a difficult case to really investigate whatsoever. I mean, we all knew what transpired in 1946, and we also knew that there was a number of these people still alive today. It was just gathering enough information that could be used to bring this case forward even further by and to get an arrest or prosecutions. So, I would have to say this wasn't one of those difficult cases. It was just finding the right evidence that could indict these folks who are still alive because, unfortunately, civil rights violations, because it is in the hands of the FBI, civil rights violations expired because they only held 5-year statute of limitations at the time.
Mm. To my knowledge, no one has ever been criminally prosecuted. There is no statute of limitations on murder, but no one to this point, to my knowledge, has been prosecuted, indicted for this act of white terrorism. There were two things I wanted to get. The first one, what you just said, I think is hugely important, and that's a point that I try to make consistently on this program. Contrary to popular opinion, white people are not ignorant about racism. One of the things that you just said, that this case, it didn't really take, a lot of painstaking effort. This isn't something that you had to go through the catacombs and dig and scrounge around. It seemed like a lot of people knew about this case, and even a lot of people had information about the people that were involved in this case. To me, that suggests that you had a lot of white people who knew, hey, these white people committed an act of murder, and we're not going to do anything to prosecute. Is that accurate?
Yes, and that's the unfortunate thing. You have a lot of great white people in that community, I have to say. But you also have those who know a lot about this murder case who can actually help in the process for the families to get justice. But, it's interesting. That part of Mississippi, that part of Georgia is quite fascinating to me because it's in these small little communities, small pockets where people are still afraid to speak out. And unfortunately, this is a case that was connected to the governor at the time. A lot of people with money was connected to the murder itself. So, and I only have to say, I can only say that's why this case haven't truly moved forward, was because of those attachments.
Context of White Supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Monday, November 18, 2019. So I have been told that date is important. We're talking about mass killings of black people on this date, November 18, 1978, Jonestown, South America, the massacre, Jim Jones, mass killing of black people, according to the reports that I saw, and we've talked about it repeatedly, approximately 70% of the victims at Jonestown were black people. So that would also qualify, in my view, as a mass killing of black people. November 18, 1978. With the theme of mass killings of black people, wowee, when Gus T or anybody else recognizes the cows 10 years that we have been broadcasting, sometimes it is nice to have a reminder. What has 10 years of the cows broadcasting produced? That audio segment that we started with, that would be one example. Mr. Keith Beauchamp, he's been a guest on this program repeatedly. The first time he visited with us, that was in 2015, and he's done documentary films, and actually he did the documentary film, The Untold Story of Emmett Lewis Till, and his work with that case got the FBI to reopen the case and some of the other, what they called cold cases from the civil rights era. And he said that one of the first cases he got involved with was the Moore's Ford Bridge lynching. That was the very first case that we talked about when he was a guest on the program. And I remember that was important for so many reasons, what he said right there at the beginning, going right to one of the core issues. I just said, when I went to hear Azure Savage right here in Seattle last week, and she was talking about her book, You Failed Us, about racism in the school system here in Seattle, the theme of white ignorance kept being used to justify acts of racism. And I questioned, I said, is this white ignorance? Is this commitment to white supremacy? Moore's Ford Bridge lynching? No, this is not white ignorance. Any stretch of the imagination, using correct terms, just going by the evidence. Anywho, we had talked about the Moore's Ford Bridge lynching before, repeatedly, and then I saw in the news of late that it's getting more attention. They are moving forward, cold case, no statute of limitations on murder, and they said that they're, I mean, this is in 1946, people die. They're having a difficult time getting plaintiffs to move forward. And they said, oh, wait a minute. There's a researcher. She wrote a book about this. We can use some of her work. She's went through, done the research, got the records. We can use some of her testimony to help continue with the case. See if we can, you know, prosecute someone, bring some justice to this finally. The book that she wrote, it is titled Fire in a Canebrake, The Last Mass Lynching in America. I will tell you a quick funny story. White people ignorant about racism. So I'm in the co-op grocery store here in Seattle yesterday evening. I'm finishing up the last couple chapters on the text, and I'm reading. I get up to go outside for a quick second. It's right next to the table where I'm sitting at, so, you know, no risk or anything. So as I'm looking outside, I have kind of one eye back on the table. I can see there's a white woman. She's seated next to my table. We never talk, but I see her at the co-op regularly, like for months, maybe even longer than that. She gets up literally from her chair and leans over to get a really good look at the book that I'm reading. And I had the cover down so you could see the title and everything. Last Mass Lynching in America. She gets up. She looks really close on it to see what it is. And then she sits back down before I walk back. I saw all of this from a distance and then walked back. And I said, we've talked about that before. People being nosy about what you are reading. When I see her next time, I am going to say something to see if she went to check out that title or if she's read this book before. But that did happen. But the book we are reading today and going to be very nosy about,
Fire in a Canebrake, The Last Mass Lynching in America. It is nonfiction about the events surrounding this lynching, what preceded these events, what took place afterwards. Man, the timing of the cows. We just talked about Walter White in the book club reading Paul Robeson. And here we are again. Walter White is front and center, one of the main characters in this book. It's absolutely amazing. In addition to writing this text, she has taught writing at the University of Georgia, as well as Johns Hopkins University, what our great president labeled a rat and rodent infested mess, the area of Baltimore, Maryland. So happy to have her on the program with us to discuss her book, These Events, What They Expose About the System of Racism. Joining us live, our guest, Laura Wexler. Ms. Wexler, are you with us?
Yes. Can you hear me?
You are crystal clear. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your Monday evening with us.
My pleasure.
For sure. For our listeners who may not have read your book, I'm sure for a lot of folks this is their first time hearing from you. Any information, kind of a quick introduction in terms of who you are, the work that you do, you'd like to share before we get started?
Sure. I wrote this book. I did the research in the late 90s. It came out in 2003, and at the time, there had been sort of, no one had put together all the pieces, the scraps of sort of gossip and information and facts and FBI report and sort of really tried to put it together and kind of say, like, this happened. This is not a fairy tale. This is not a legend. This is not a spooky story. This actually really did happen. Because I think before the book came out, at least when I first learned about the lynching, which was in 1997, there were people who said, you know, that it hadn't happened, or that could deny it. I guess there was plausible deniability. There was an official history of Walton County where this lynching happened. It was never mentioned in that. And so I think what motivated me was to find out as much as I could that was verifiable about the lynching, put it together and kind of make it so that no one could say this never happened. So that was the real motivation. And of course I did, you know, I did want to find the smoking gun in case this is the story of a lynching, a gunshot lynching, which a lot of times when I would tell people I'm working on a book about a lynching and I mentioned that it was a gunshot lynching, a lot of people that doesn't compute for them, right? They think of a lynching as someone hanging from a tree, which of course is the classic and terrifying image of American history. But this happened in 1946. There were lots of servicemen who had returned from, you know, fighting for quote unquote democracy overseas. And so there were guns everywhere. And so this is how they did them. They did them with guns rather than with, you know, with a rope, but it was a lynching nonetheless, right? Because we know a lynching is, it's a murder committed as, you know, extra legal justice. So to punish someone or someones, in this case, for committing either a legal wrong or a social wrong. And it's also then a threat to everybody else to, you know, behave, stay in your place. Don't, you know, don't try to get your rights. Don't ask for more. So anyway, as much as possible, I talked to everybody who would talk to me. I was listening and you had, someone on earlier who said, like, it wasn't hard to get the information about the lynching. I mean, I don't know if I agree with that. I think it was hard. I think even in 1997, you know, 50 years after the lynching happened, people were still scared to talk about it. Like, it was still a real liability to know anything. on the one hand, and then other people didn't want to talk about it because they didn't want their town or county to get a bad name. So I think there was a lot of resistance. And I think part of the reason this crime hasn't been solved is because people don't want to talk about it. They don't want their family to be involved. They don't want to have to say something bad about a relative or a person in their family. So I still think there's a lot of secret keeping.
Context of White Supremacy, great introduction. We will get to that. Again, that was Keith Beauchamp, who was speaking about the ease of getting information. I actually think both of those things could be true, but we'll get to that in a moment. I do want to point out a pattern really quickly in terms of, you said in the historical record of the town, Monroe, Georgia, in the county where this took place, there's no record, no mentioning of these events, which had such a huge impact on the state, the country, the president got involved in all this. Is not uncommon. We just in the book club,
correct,
we read Sundown Towns, and that James Lowen, he talked about how that is very common. In fact, that is pretty much the rule. No matter how common, no matter how much notoriety the case got, it generally is not mentioned. Even if that means they drove out all the Negroes in the town, if that means thousands of them, burned them down, killed all the people, it will be totally erased and not mentioned at all, which in my view goes back, it is not white ignorance. This is all by design in terms of practicing racism.
Well, unfortunately, it leads to white ignorance, right? Because then people, they don't know.
I just want to hang on to be clear. I'm saying absolutely not. White people, they might not know the details of this, but in terms of white people being ignorant about racism, white supremacy, absolutely not. And even from Mr. Lowen, and matter of fact, we'll get to some of that with this case right now. That's why I said what Mr. Beauchamp, what he said can be true, and what you said can be true about white people lying. But I want to be very clear, there is no white ignorance, because you said it produces or leads to white ignorance, and I'm saying absolutely not. White people are not ignorant about racism, even if we want to talk micro, even about this case.
Well, white I love James Lowen's book.
Hang on one second. I do want to make sure that we don't have interrupting for the program. I'm not going to interrupt you when I ask you questions when you're speaking, and I don't want to be interrupted either. And I want to try to cover as much information as possible. If you want to respond to that, I'll give you a chance. I just want to make sure, because there was one other quick pattern I wanted to make sure I get out. The Eulabis, she's been on the program. You mentioned a lot about white people convening at phone poles, lynchings that took place, sometimes involving a rope, sometimes a gun, whatever it might be. Eulabis was a guest on the program. We talked all about that. She intended to write a book about telephones and the erection of telephone poles and how that spread communication, and got totally diverted because of the number of lynchings that took place at telephone poles, although the Moores Ford Bridge lynching is not at a telephone pole. Patterns. Mm-hmm. All righty. Getting to exacts, things I wanted to get to your book. There are two quick questions, and then we will be fire in a canebrake. Or three. Number one, super important. Are you a white woman, Ms. Wexler?
Yes.
Very important. Thank you kindly. This program, I use the term white supremacy and the term racism as synonyms. I use the same definition for both terms, and the definition I use for both is as follows. A global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
Oh my gosh, I have to chew on that. Can you say it again?
Absolutely. So racism, white supremacy, same definition for both terms. That definition again, a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Is the definition accurate? Does such a system exist?
Okay. So would I then be answering yes to your question, am I white? Would I then be classifying myself according to your definition? Would I be saying that that's what I am according to your definition?
Well, that's not, I didn't ask anything about you personally. That's not the question at all. The question,
okay.
Again, is...
Just wanted to make sure I wasn't agreeing to something totally hideous about myself. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. You want me to give it to you one more time?
Yeah. Sure. I go along with that. That sounds fine. Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. And before I get to... the book. Oh, I have two more before we get to the book. One is an easy one from your, we'll do that one first. In fact, I was looking at your website, which I linked in the description for the program, and it was talking about all of your accomplishments, your work at University of Georgia and blah, 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 and all this. And it said you were working on a feature film based on an infamous 1924 racial passing case. And I said, what is that all about? Can we get some details?
Sure. This is actually I'm still at work on it, but there was a case called the Rhinelander Affair. Have you ever heard of this?
No, ma'am.
So it was in early 1920s New York, and it was kind of an infamous case at the time. It was the son of a really well-heeled family. Their last name was Rhinelander. They were sort of up with like the Vanderbilts, kind of that level of money and kind of lineage. That son fell in love with a woman who appeared to be a working class white woman. They fell in love, got married, and several against his parents' wishes, because she was not of his world, quote unquote. A few weeks after they got married, there was an article printed in the paper saying Rhinelander heir weds colored woman. And it started this whole legal case in which he tried to divorce. He was forced by his parents to sue her to annul the marriage on the basis that she had deceived him about having mixed blood, being mixed, not being fully white, according to the definitions of the time, which, you know, are all over the place. But and at the time, it was an illegal, interracial marriage was not illegal in New York. So they had to come at it as a contract issue, that she had defrauded him, and therefore the contract, which was the marriage, should be null and void. But in fact, he had known that she had mixed blood. They had written letters to each other where they talked about seeing each other nude, and he had seen her family. He knew all of this. And so he begged her, it's a really strange case, but he begged her to fight this and prove that she was white so that it wouldn't be fraudulent, and so they could stay married. And it sort of just went on from there. And it really is a case that I think gets at both the tragedy and the absurdity of these definitions of race, you know, whether it was one drop, one eighth, whatever it was. And you know, this ruined their lives. I mean, they ruined their marriage, and they, you know, she never married again. She ended up living until the 1980s. He died very quickly after the trial, but it ruined both of them. So anyway, it's a really, really fascinating case, and a love story and a legal drama, and, you know, yet another story about American race, which happens to be something I'm really, really just continued to be so moved by. So that's the story on that.
Awesome. We'll look for the feature film on this. I have to look into that. Look into that case. Before I get to this question, I ask this question many, many times when we have white guests on the program, but rarely do I get to get a section from their book or article or something we're discussing as a lead into the question. So this is from page 244 of Fire in a Canebrake. Ms. Wexler writes, Linda Lemons lives 5 miles from Hestertown and works part-time for the post office. When she's driving the roads of Walton County delivering mail, she thinks about sin and repentance. She wonders what her father knew about the lynching and if he asked for forgiveness before he died. A devout Christian, she worries that those who participated in the lynching, some of whom were her neighbors and relatives, which would suggest that she was not ignorant, are being punished in the afterlife. The thought of their suffering causes her grief, and yet she sees no alternative. These people committed a murder, and I don't know that they ever realized it was a bad thing, she says. At the time, they had no remorse. The whole community let it go by. She pauses, then says, I know it was a great wrong. The question. There was a non-white author a few years back. He wrote a piece on white supremacy racism, and he said that white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism, but rarely are they pained enough. And I've been asking our white guests the first portion of that sentence. Do you think it's true based on you are classified as white, so your family, friends, white people that you've been around, you're studied, you said this is a topic, studying racism, white supremacy in America, at least, has been something you've been moved by. So just based on your studies, your experience, your view, do you think that a substantial, and particularly in the context of the Moores Ford Bridge lynching, do you think that a substantial number of white people are greatly and sincerely pained by racism?
In the case of the lynch, with regard to the lynching in particular, I would say in general, no, not enough. And specifically, no, not enough. Yeah.
Much obliged. Thank you for the honesty. We have had a number of white people on the program for a while. Most of the white people said no. And then a lot of them, you know, started going the other way. In my view, got to be truthful on that one and say, and I always ask when they say yes, I ask, well, how is it demonstrated? And if you had said, oh, yeah, I think a substantial number of white people are greatly pained about the Moores Ford Bridge case, my follow-up question is always, how is it demonstrated? And I don't know how white people can say they've demonstrated sincere and great pain about these events. But I guess you didn't tell us exactly how did you get sparked into this case? Were you interested before you read
it? Yeah, I was working at the University of Georgia, and I saw an article in the student newspaper there that was about the Moores Ford Committee. And the Moores Ford Committee was a group of black and white citizens of the area, Walton and Oconee County, who formed to memorialize the victims of the lynching. And so my entry point into this case was really my interest in this group. I thought that this was a really powerful and kind of unique and interesting thing that they were doing. And so I reached out to some of the members of the group and I said, can I write an article about your group? And I'll never forget, I met them in the cemetery. They were cleaning the cemetery where one of the victims is buried, Marie Dorsey. It's a cemetery there used to be a church on the property and it had this cemetery, but the church moved and they sold the land to, at the time I was there, it was to like a car repair shop. And the car repair shop was like almost on top of these graves and the graveyard was in real disrepair. And so this committee was there, I think it was a Saturday afternoon or a Sunday afternoon, working to restore some dignity and order to this cemetery. And so I went around and began talking to people. Why are you here? What do you know about this case? What's your relationship? Just really trying to understand the group itself and the people in it. And that day I realized like that nobody nobody really knew exactly what had happened in the lynching. I mean, there were lots of versions of what might have happened. And there were, as I mentioned, like scraps and bits and pieces and things that seemed true and maybe were, but nobody really knew. And it was really that day that I thought, I want to see if I can use my research and reporting skills to see if I can put this story together to the extent that it can be put together, which, as it turns out, it can be put together, but there is a hole in the middle, which is the actual lynching itself, which we do not have. We don't have a verifiable and accurate account of. So that's how it began.
Much obliged for that. And it took from 1997, the book was published in 2003. You spent about 6 years, is that accurate, researching, preparing this book?
Yeah, I did. I worked on it part-time for a couple years and then full-time for a year. So I think I first heard about it in 97, and then I worked on it really 98 through 2002, because, you know, you finish a book and then it takes a year for it to go through the publication process, but you're not really working on it.
Got it.
So okay. About 4 years.
Okay. Much obliged. Appreciate the
many hours.
I'm certain. with the details of the actual case, and for folks, again, a decade plus, almost 11 years at this point, one of those programs at the dark end of the street, Danielle McGuire's book, where she talks about Rosa Parks and, for many other black females, the history of being raped by white men throughout the system of white supremacy, and how that was a big part of these, what they call civil rights movement, and black people fighting back and saying, we're not going to be victims of rape. We're going to fight back. We'll defend ourselves. You start this book with the dispute. Before we get to the actual lynching, summer of 1946, this opens with Roger Malcolm, black male, who is upset. There are rumors that his wife might be messing around with a white man. And this rumor, I guess, keeps coming up over and over in the book. You started with this, in fact, with the book. Why did you start with this? And can you talk about that as a rumor for what led to the stabbing that allegedly is what prompted this lynching to begin with?
Your questions are so good, so thank you. I started with that. I mean, it took me many drafts to figure out how to start the book. And the reason I started with that is that stabbing did set into motion the chain of events that 11 days later resulted in this lynching. And this period of 11 days between the stabbing, and then there was the first election, the first gubernatorial election in Georgia that black people had been allowed to vote in. This was a primary, since the end of Reconstruction. So this was like such a intense period of days, both statewide, but then specifically in this area because of this stabbing. But the other reason I started with this is because one of the things I wanted to show in the book, and one of the things I strongly felt was true of this lynching, is that there was no shared history. There was no shared agreement on what had happened. So we knew that Roger Malcolm had stabbed Barnett Hester. That was a fact. But everything else, why he did it, whether it was self-defense, whether Barnett Hester and Dorothy Malcolm had been having a consensual relationship, or whether, as you just mentioned, this was not a consensual relationship and Roger Malcolm was defending her or in some way getting justice for her. Those were two interpretations of the same action. And I was really interested in that duality as being authentic to kind of how black and white people can tend to view history. As I put like in the back of the book, you know, I was writing this at the time of the Rodney King beating and all these cases where I was so struck by the division, like, you know, whether someone's hand was raised to wave or whether it was a hand was raised to strike. It really depended on who you were and what your history was and what your experience had been in America. And so I wanted to sort of set that up as a motif in the book, that there were these dualities or these multiple versions of the same event that really showed how far apart people were living, though they were living very close to each other, how far apart they were living in their understanding.
Mm.
Does that make sense?
It does make sense, and certainly I have no idea about what Roger Malcolm's motivations were about the stabbing or sexual activity of anyone involved, but that, number one, because at this time period, a black, and you mentioned throughout the book, this is, this case, 1946, we're almost a decade before Emmett Till, so certainly a black person could be killed for looking at a white woman. Reckless eyeballing, they called
mm-hmm.
it. That was very common. Yeah. Could have happened to anyone. Certainly a black female is not going to jump up and down. This white man, you know, is eyeballing me or wants me, anything, is having sex with me or anything else, is not going to be able to go and complain to anyone. Certainly not in Georgia,
right.
Alabama, anywhere else. But to start, like, wow, we're going into, or I'll give you my perspective to why that stood out to me. Number one, I've already said that's such a huge component of white supremacy, racism. There are tons of books written about that, tons of whole towns that have been burned down. James Lowen, sundown towns, the whole lot of times that's happened, accusation that a black person looked at a white woman. But to start the book with that, well, we're going into this lynching, and to even think that for this case, that a theory could be that this started all with a black male stabbing a white man because there could have been a suspicion. Maybe it was consensual. I don't know. Maybe he was raping her. Maybe it wasn't happening at all. But to go into another lynching where somehow sexual intercourse between a white person and a black person is right there, again, as a possible catalyst for all of this. I can't say it's surprising. It's kind of cliche,
yeah.
I would say, in the system of white supremacy.
I agree. I agree. And, you know, again, the idea that the white people who lived in Hestertown, to them, Roger Malcolm had just come at Barnett Hester because he was violent or because he was drunk or because he was there was no possibility in their mind that Roger Malcolm could have a legitimate motive of self-defense or justice. Right. And then the opposite was true, you know, among Roger Malcolm and Dorothy Malcolm's friends, that they knew the history. They assumed there was something going on like that. But one of the things that really struck me was when I was interviewing people, you know, in Hestertown, so in the area where this stabbing happened, you know, 50 years later in the 90s, and some people's memories were these were older white women whose husbands may or may not have been involved, but they were definitely farmers in the area and held like clan-like ideas, if not being in the clan. And in these women's memories, Roger Malcolm had killed Barnett Hester. Barnett Hester had died that day. Some of them misremembered. And, you know, as much as I'm interested, you know, as a nonfiction writer in what people remember that's accurate, I'm also interested in what people remember that's not accurate and why, you know, and how, again, to misremember that Roger Malcolm killed Barnett Hester that day. In fact, Roger Malcolm was the one who died of this, you know, 11 days later. But to misremember that, again, is to really see how people understand the world through their lens of white supremacy, you know?
Absolutely. Words are super important. I think lie is a more accurate word than misremember. And I point that out just because it seems so frequently in these cases when at the end of James Lowen's other book, Lies My Teacher Told Me, at the end of the day, so many times, that's what we're talking about. And it seems that the thesaurus will be worn out to find anything other than saying white people lie. White people lie. And particularly that lie is in James Loewen's book a lot too, where a black person or sometimes a whole lot of black people will be falsely accused, white lies, of some sort of crime to justify whatever lynching or whatever happened afterwards. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe we did burn down the whole time, but they raped a white woman or something. They did do something that warranted all of this. That is super pattern of white supremacy. I wanted to ask, you pivot from kind of introducing and who some of these folks are, naming the victims, George Dorsey, Dorothy Malcolm, May Murray Dorsey, Roger Malcolm. In, I think, Democracy Now! And Keith Beauchamp, many of the other folks, when they talk about this case, they will emphasize Dorothy Malcolm being pregnant. You kind of talked about it. Well, that's kind of reported. Maybe it's not. Is that something that you could substantiate, whether or not she was pregnant at the time of this slaughter?
Here's my take on that, and is absolutely my opinion. My opinion is that given the level of specificity and detail with which the bodies of these victims were described by Pittsburgh Courier reporters and photographers, and by Dan Young, who ran the funeral home where they were laid out, I do believe if she had been visibly pregnant and there had been something like evidence of a baby being cut out, that would have been in the headlines of these, of the newspaper. It would have been in Dan Young's messages to the NAACP, and it was not in anything of the time. It just wasn't there. So I think that was, certainly we know there are cases where that has happened. It absolutely has happened. History proves that. So that's one of the things that just gets really complex in cases like this, because it could be true. In this case, I do not think it is, but it's, to me, it's not, again, it's my opinion based on, my research and the fact that, those reporters and photographers did such an amazing job of describing the horror that I do think they would have mentioned that.
The black newspapers, she mentioned the Pittsburgh Courier and Chicago Defender, the black.
And Atlanta Daily World and all that. I mean, particularly the Pittsburgh Courier.
Black journalists did an amazing, we've had whole programs on that and the importance of black journalists within the system and talking about these incidents and giving this incident a lot of attention to spur outrage and to spur more action. Within all of that, you also, in kind of giving context to these events, and I can even give an error, strive for accuracy. When we had Mr. Beauchamp on the program, I referenced Eugene Talmadge as the governor at the time of these events. That is kind of a slight error. To be totally accurate, it would be governor-elect, but it is still important who he is and what was happening. And I think if I'm accurate, oh man, the Cal's Book Club can shine on this one. What have we been doing for a decade? So Georgia is right next to South Carolina, one of my all-time favorites, Benjamin Pitchfork, the former governor in South Carolina, co-founder of Clemson. He sounds very similar to Eugene Talmadge, former South Carolina governor. Can you tell us a bit about the governor-elect, Mr. Talmadge, and why this was significant to the lynching?
Yeah, I mean, as I mentioned earlier, 1946, July 17th, 1946 was going to be the first statewide primary election, Democratic primary, in which black people had the right to vote since the end of Reconstruction. The reason that's important is because Georgia was a one-party state. So the Democratic primary was the only election that mattered. And so essentially there had been disenfranchisement before this. So This was as a result of a Supreme Court case called the Primus King case that had been decided in 1944. And so on the heels of this decision, there had been huge voter cultivation, African-American voter cultivation, and there was going to be really big turnout. So there was a lot of fear that that black people would basically in Georgia would have power in the election and be able to really vote as a block and have quite a bit of influence on who won. So Eugene Talmadge, who had been governor before, so on July 14th, the governor was Governor Ellis Arnall. But as the campaign went on that summer, Eugene Talmadge basically campaigned saying, black people better not vote. If they vote, I'm going to threaten them. He went around campaigning saying, if you vote for me, white people, because he didn't expect to get any black votes, if you vote for me, I'll make sure blacks don't vote in Atlanta, vote in Georgia anymore. So he ran an election that was completely outwardly and unapologetically racist, white supremacist, violent. All of these, he was a demagogue. He was an absolute demagogue. And his strategy was to, rile up whites with fear, not unlike the current demagogue who we have as president now. Demagogues are actually not that dissimilar. They use many of the same strategies. And to scare black people to stay away from the polls. And he did all sorts of crooked voter getting people off the rolls and all this stuff. But anyway, he visited Walton County between the time of the stabbing and the lynching. And many people believe that he gave his support to some kind of action like this. Whether he knew that it was going to be four people and not just Roger Malcolm, I don't know. I don't think anyone knows. But there was definitely an atmosphere of hysteria and violence that was really linked to this election and the sense of, like, if black people can vote, it will be the end of life as white people in Georgia have known it.
Very reminiscent of Benjamin Pitchfork Tillman, South Carolina. We read his biography, former governor in South Carolina, and was thinking about running for president for a time. He used many of the same tactics, just putting a tab in for fear. And even some of the tricks where he would pay black people to go down and sit next to white people so that they're like, oh my gosh, if we don't put Talmadge in, the Negroes are going to run wild. We are reading a biography on Paul Robeson in the book club, and Walter White is mentioned prominently. And then lo and behold, he's one of the key figures in this book too. I was going to get you to share about some of the work that he did around this case. People were talking about his efforts with the NAACP. I do think it's important. Walter White was very pale. He could, what they call, pass for, talking about your concept, he could pass for white. I think he even had a white parent. I think he had blue eyes. He used that to his advantage to be able to investigate cases like the Moores Ford Bridge lynching. He's been mentioned a ton of times over the decade we've been broadcasting. He was in Warmth of Other Suns, where he talked about, in fact, he was investigating a lynching case, and a white man came up and told him, there's a light-skinned nigger down here looking to cause us trouble, and we're going to lynch him. And he said, oh my, I think they're talking about me. I better get out of here. But you write on 151, this is discussed Walter White, NAACP Executive Secretary Walter White, who organized the emergency committee in the wake of the Moores Ford lynching, opened the meeting at the White House that day by reviewing the year's most notable incidents of racial violence. If he hadn't selected only those incidents that had received widespread publicity in the white press, The review would have taken hours. As it was, the president sat quietly, his elbows resting on the arms of his chair, as White described the deaths of two black men and the destruction of the entire black business district in Columbia, Tennessee, detailed the blinding of Isaac Woodard in South Carolina, and then listed the year's six lynching victims, four killed in Georgia, one in Mississippi, one in Louisiana. At least the excuse given for the torture and execution in Nazi concentration camps was that the victims were enemies of the state, said White. But recent victims of American lynchers were in numerous instances men who fought for its preservation overseas. Instead of gratitude, they have been paid off in savagery. Great line from Mr. White. Can you talk about his relevance to this case and his important point at the end about black servicemen coming back and that also being an important part of what happened with the lynching fever?
Yes. I mean, I loved learning about him through this case and learning about, you know, his investigations, as you mentioned. And the night of the lynching, basically what happened was Dan Young, who was a black undertaker in Monroe, was able to get word to Atlanta to a friend he had there, to a black businessman in Atlanta who was the brother-in-law of Walter White. And through that chain of folks, they were able to get the information very quickly to Walter White about this lynching. And then he sent it to the attorney general. So Walter White was really, he was really responsible for getting word out about the lynching to the authorities. The federal authorities, instead of just like the state authorities, really getting the word out, but also continuing to put pressure, and later Thurgood Marshall as well, to put pressure on the attorney general and the FBI to send investigators to, work diligently to try to investigate this. And then they also, as sometimes happened, NAACP used its own funds to hire an investigator to go down to Monroe and investigate. So he was really like at the center of, you know, making this, keeping this lynching before people's eyes, making sure people knew about it, galvanizing the public response, but also using his considerable political pressure, to try to get some justice in it. And then finally to get to the president and, talk so movingly. Yes, that line, instead of gratitude, they've been paid off in savagery. And, you know, we know Truman was, I can't remember the source of this. I have it in the footnotes, but, that eventually his horror at the fact that particularly the servicemen being killed in their own country led him to create the President's Committee on Civil Rights, and then eventually, within a few years, integrate the armed services. So Walter White was just amazing activist, thinker, communicator, and so essential to, so essential to this case having the impact that it did.
We will hear more about him on Thursday and his relationship with Mr. Paul Robeson, but for the time being, I wanted to reading, get to mention so many books from our book club. One of my all time favorites, top 10, Vincent Woodard, 2014, The Delectable Negro, Human Consumption and Homoeroticism in U.S. Slave Culture. Oh, one of the best books I've ever read on racism, white supremacy. Keep that book in mind, The Delectable Negro. I was even thinking of that when you said earlier, when I was asking you about the definition, you said you had to chew on that. Delectable Negro, keep that in mind. This is the bottom of page 72 of Fire in a Canebrake. You write, the crowd gathered in the clearing that morning wasn't interested in Moore's Ford except as a killing place, for they'd come to participate in the long tradition of collecting lynching souvenirs. Walton County's first recorded lynching had occurred in 1890 when a black man named Jim Harmon, who was accused of touching a white woman's face while she slept, was shot to death. His body sank to the bottom of a pond. It had produced no souvenirs. But some of the county citizens were likely among the huge crowds that witnessed the lynching of a black man named Sam Hose near Atlanta 9 years later. After Sam Hose was hung and burned to death, men rushed at him with knives. They cut off his fingers, ears, and penis, then scavenged for limbs from the lynching tree, ashes from the fire, anything that bore the mark of the lynching. This urge to collect and preserve provided young W.E.B. Du Bois a glimpse of Sam Hose's knuckle bones on display at an Atlanta grocery store a few days later. No doubt there were also some citizens of Walton County among those who flocked to nearby Watkinsville, the Oconee County seat, on June 30, 1905, to collect cartridge shells and other things as mementos from the bodies of eight men who'd been taken out from the county jail the night before and lynched. The mob that lynched Tom Allen near Toller's Woods in Walton County 6 years later discouraged such souvenir collecting by pinning notes to his body that instructed people to leave it hanging as long as possible. The mob members reasoned that the longer Tom Allen's body hung, the longer it could serve as a warning to black men inclined to commit similar crimes. Those who wanted souvenirs made do with photographs of Tom Allen's body, which sold briskly in Monroe. Some were mounted and framed for display with the addition of a postage stamp. Others became postcards carrying family news and gossip, as well as a record of the lynching from Monroe to places all over the country. Whew, the last paragraph, Falcon. On this Friday morning in 1946, there was no possibility of retrieving body parts or photographs of the lynch victims since the four bodies had been transported to Monroe late the evening before, so the souvenir collectors made do once again. A white student who detoured to Moore's Ford on his way to class at the University of Georgia, your alma mater, in Athens, found a length of rope with a few cords clipped off by a bullet. As he was leaving the clearing with his souvenir in hand, another man snatched it. After hunting again, the student found a tooth, which he later gave to a friend for her charm bracelet. Four-leaf clovers, wishbones, good luck charms on bracelets. You know, Indian head pennies, he says. She felt like that tooth would be something. I could read more, but I will just stop there and again give the name of the book in my top 10, The Delectable Negro, Human Consumption and Homoeroticism in U.S. Slave Culture, Gus's top 10. You wrote all this, Miss Wexler. What would motivate such behavior? What does this reveal about Calais? It's not like this is a one-time thing. This is over and over and over, not just in Georgia. What would feed such a desire to consume, come to a burial site and consume these scraps? What would feed this behavior?
You know, I still remember talking to this guy who told me about getting this tooth, and he was an old guy. By the time I talked to him, he was this old guy. I don't remember how I met him, but I remember that he had no shame. He wasn't sheepish at all, even all those years later, to tell me this story. And it was one of the most chilling moments of doing research, because it felt like face to face with kind of the banality of evil, like that he still had no conception that what he saw as collecting a four-leaf clover was terrorizing. He had no idea. And t- to him, it was just like a normal thing to do. You know, it was, I have no words really. I just remember feeling like, I cannot believe you don't see how barbarian that is. But he didn't. He really didn't. And so did countless other people did not. How does the book make sense of that you mentioned? How does it make sense of that kind of behavior?
Well, I'm asking you, you know, that was the question, which I didn't think got answered. But I do want to also point out, I think that was another manifestation of white ignorance, that he didn't get it. He had no idea. And again, I push back so strongly, because this white man is what you're talking about, him collecting the tooth of Dorothy May, Roger Malcolm, grabbing one of their teeth to give to a girlfriend as a charm bracelet. And his explanation so many years later, that, in my view, is not white ignorance. But I will ask the question again, because I wanted your thoughts. What do you think? And again,
I think it's a dehumanization to the extent that it feels like picking a four-leaf clover or a wishbone. That's a level of dehumanization that has occurred, and that's what was so chilling to me, to come face to face with that, was chilling.
What do you think is the value in having, you know, I've got Roger Malcolm's teeth in a jar. I've had them there for 10 years. What do you think that's why I said, because it's collective. This is not a one-time thing. This is over and over and over and over, the postcards and all of it. What do you think the value is for white women, white men, white children to hold on to the trinkets of a murdered black person? I've got a black person's penis or testicles, had it in a jar for 10 years. What is the value of having that? What does that signify to white people?
It's a trophy. I mean, that's what I would say. It's a trophy. And on the one hand, and on the other hand, again, I think it's, how do I say this? I keep thinking about this guy, because this is the personal, you know, the personal interaction I had, but he is just a dehumanization. He didn't see that it would be he didn't see that it was connected to something of value for somebody else. I don't know. I'm not being very articulate about it. I think the sending of postcards, I remember when I lived in Georgia, I knew the guy. Have you seen the book of photographs? And there was also an exhibit called Without Sanctuary. It's a it's a book that was based on this guy's collection of these lynching postcards. And he had found them at antique stores and collected them. And I remember seeing the exhibit in New York, and you know, you would see these photographs, and there were all these white people in the photographs pointing to the lynching and then sending them later. And it's just that it was a complete dehumanization pinnacle of white power and terror. I don't know. I'm not being articulate. I'm sorry.
Interesting. Context of White Supremacy. Again, our guest, Laura Wexler, we're discussing her book, Fire in a Canebrake, The Last Mass Lynching in America. If you would like more information as to this hoarding, consuming of black body parts, the delectable Negro, human consumption, homoeroticism, and U.S. slave culture by Vincent Woodard in our book club,
I pay attention to words are important. I pay attention to wording. And in the text, I noted the times where you use the term terror or fear in talking about Black people and white people. And I contrasted. I looked at different incidents on page 27. This is talking about the election. We were just talking about that. The next morning, nearly 7,000 Black people in Atlanta voted for a cussing, whiskey-drinking, cigarette-smoking lawyer named Helen Mankin, and she won, becoming Georgia's first female member of Congress. By waiting until the last minute, Black leaders had given their support to Mankin, the only candidate who campaigned for their votes without causing a backlash from her white supporters. Black voters had voted in a block, and for the first time since the end of Reconstruction, they played a role in a congressional election in Georgia. As the news of Mankin's win traveled through the state, it energized Black leaders and terrified many white leaders. That was one use of terrified. On page 37, flipping forward a little bit. Okay. Top of 37. And yet, at the same time, many white Southerners feared the return of Black veterans to the South. They also worried about the record numbers of Black people leaving. Both phenomena, after all, signified a loss of white control. As a result of the exodus, white landowners confronted labor shortages and resulting higher wages, both potentially disastrous. I'll pause right there, but we heard the fear again around Black veterans, Black voters, and worried about Black labor shortages, which comes up here too. Even that came up. I think Lloyd Harrison complained, like, why would I be involved in the lynching? Like, I lost some of my laborers. Like, I'm upset about this. So fear continuing on 42, boop, boop, flipping forward a couple page, paying attention to fear and terror. So the bottom of 42, late that night, a group of white men did park their cars in Towler's Woods, leaving their headlights burning while they stood in a group to drink the free whiskey provided by Eugene Talmadge's campaign. Most of the men were Barnett Hester's friends or relatives. Mr. Hester was the one who was stabbed, white man. Many had visited him at the hospital. Some were angry about an incident that happened the same day Roger Malcolm stabbed Barnett Hester. The daughters of several Blassingame farmers had been driving together to Monroe when a carload of Black men tried to flirt with them. Uh-oh. The Black men were drunk, and the white girls got frightened. They stopped at a filling station along the Atlanta-Athens Highway, told the white owner what had happened, and waited 15 minutes before driving off again. Then, when they turned off the highway at Acock's store near the Moores Ford Bridge, they saw the Black men again. In the end, they made it home safely, but one of the girls was so distraught that she had to stay out of school the following day. The last illustration of fear that pops up in the book, just to contrast, this is on 199. Towards the end of the book, talking about Lamar Howard, Black male, victim of racism. He was beaten around his testimony around this case. I'll even give a little extra. This is bottom of 198. On February 24th, 1947, so this is about 6 months after the lynching, 4 days after Georgia Governor Herman Talmadge signed a white primary bill into law, if I couldn't keep Papa from dying, at least I could keep him from dying in vain, he said. A capacity crowd of nearly 200 white people and 20 Black people filled Monroe's stately courthouse to witness what many were calling the trial of the year. The state had dropped charges against Tom Verner, who was slated for Army reenlistment, but retained charges against James Verner. If convicted of assault and battery, he faced 6 months in jail or 12 months in a public works camp and a $1,000 fine. Lamar Howard was the prosecution's first witness. When he took the stand and testified that James Verner had been beaten him at the ice plant on New Year's Day, he felt everyone looking at him, the whites on the floor, the Blacks in the gallery above. He was scared. And though nearly 2 months had passed since Verner's had clubbed him with a pistol, his head hurt. But as the morning wore on, each succeeding witness strengthened Lamar Howard's testimony. Monroe's police chief testified that James Verner had told him, "Yes, I beat him, and I'll beat the hell out of him again." And Tom Verner testified that he'd watched his brother beat Lamar Howard and admitted he'd noticed his brother's knuckles were bloody afterward. I will stop there. And the reason I do the contrast around fear is that I hear that even now, when someone is terrified, and it's something related to racism. I'll hear that white people are afraid. They said that Darren Woodson was afraid of Michael Brown Jr. And I pay attention to when white people, even it's reported that they're afraid, and I just contrast. I look at Lamar Howard, who it doesn't seem like there's a whole lot of discrepancy. He was beaten, pistol whipped by a white man. He would have reason to be afraid, as would any black person, where a whole crowd of blacks can be lynched in broad daylight and no one prosecuted ever. These other incidents of white people being fearful or terrified about black veterans or black voters or a carload of drunk black people, I mean, what reason would you have to be afraid? We can purge voters whenever we feel like it. We can kill black people whenever we feel like it. Why would these white people be afraid, fearful, terrorized of black people in 1940, really in 2019, but I mean, we can stick with 1940. Why would they be afraid of Roger? I mean, really? Does that even make sense to you, Ms. Wexler?
I mean, no, it doesn't to me personally, but I think according to the stories they lived by, that made sense to them, you know? So that, and you know, we live by our stories. That's kind of what I was trying to get to with starting the book as I did, that, you know, you could have the same event and according to the stories you live by, that will shape your interpretation and thus your reaction to it. So, you know, these white Southerners had been taught to or raised to, or they were deciding to, all of the above, view the world that way. And, you know, especially at this moment with Eugene Talmadge going around whipping up fear, which is a fairly easy thing to do to make people scared. I mean, again, I keep referring, I mean, when I listen to Trump now, I think so much of Eugene Talmadge. I really do. It's the classic, you know, pit people against each other. This was a classic tactic in the South. I think some people were genuinely scared. These girls were probably genuinely scared. Should they have been? No, but they were. And that was because they were living by those stories.
This, again, is one of those moments where I just say white people lie. And I think that's important, it being stated so explicitly, because if what's happening is that is a part of racism, white supremacy, that you can always lie and say that a black person frightened you and that can justify anything. If you had to kill 20 black people, if you have to kill a black child, like whatever it is, I was afraid. It was a car full of black people, and I was afraid. It was black people going to vote.
Yeah, you.
President Obama's going to take our guns. Anything. All you have to do, black person, I was afraid. And, well, that seems reasonable. The Negroes are scared. And what I'm saying is that it is a total lie, because we're in a system of racism, white supremacy. If that's true, I shouldn't have to say anything else. And we agreed on that at the beginning. I shouldn't have to say anything else. That means I can do anything I want. We can totally dominate this black person at any time. And this whole book is pretty much about that. We would have justice in this case if that were not true. So there's no reason. I mean, it's not even logical. It's what you were saying about it's easy to whip up people to be fearful. It's easy to whip up people to practice racism, white supremacy. It's easy to whip up fear about black people, in particular, black males, non-white people, very easy. I even be in particular about words. Ben Tillman, Eugene Talmadge, President Donald J. Trump, they do not whip people up against each other. I have not heard any of these individuals make a speech where they're going out to an audience of black people and trying to whip them up in anger against white people or anybody else for that matter. What I've heard consistently is what seem like appeals to racism, white supremacy. That is not pitting people against each other. That should be stated explicitly if what's being done is practicing white supremacy racism. Going back to Delectable Negro, because there are so many of those type of moments in this book. This is on 87, and then I'll nab some of the folks who dialed in with a question from, let's see, 87, I guess I'll do the bottom of 86. Bottom of 86. Mary Alice Avery, the stepdaughter of Isaac Bruce, the black man who helped clean the bodies at Almond Funeral Home, went to the viewing on a date with her fiancé. They passed through the entrance and entered the main room of the funeral home, where the four bodies lay on a row of stretchers. Even at midday, it was dark in there, and the windows shrouded by heavy curtains, the room's bare wooden floors and stained walls illuminated by a few dim bulbs. While some passed the bodies quickly, looking and not looking, Mary Alice Avery and her fiancé studied them. At the far end of the row lay Roger Malcolm, his face pocked with the plaster of Paris Dan Young had used to conceal the damage to his face. But nothing could hide the hole in Roger Malcolm's cheek. It was larger than a quarter, the result of a shotgun fired at close range. Dorothy's body lay next to Roger's, a bandage covering her face where the right side of her jaw had been blown away. It was evidently her tooth that the white student had found on the ground near Moore's Ford the morning before and given to his friend for her charm bracelet. Next to Dorothy lay her brother George. His right eye was covered with a bandage. It had been shot out, and his right ear, which had been partially shot off, was attached to his head by tape. And last in the row was May Murray Dorsey, whose eyes, nose, and ears were unmarred, and whose long straight hair, the envy of local black men and women alike, colorism, they say, framed her pale face in death as it had in life. May Murray looked as if she were sleeping. Her face, unlike the others, wasn't a record of her death. That day, Mary Alice Avery looked closely and tried to remember everything as she walked past the row of bodies. Dorothy with her swollen jaw, George with a bump like a thimble on the top of his head, May with a neat round bullet hole in the back of her head, when Mary Alice Avery and her fiancé returned to stand in front of Roger Malcolm, they peeled back from the funeral blanket and looked at his body. They kind of lacerated Roger. They had stuck him or cut him. He was tortured for sure, she says. The others just had bullet wounds, but he had been attacked. They'd heard he'd been castrated, so they pulled the blanket all the way down. He was castrated, she says, like the privates halfway cut off, something kind of hanging. After they finished viewing the bodies, people walked outside, blinking in the sunlight. Some, like Mary Alice Avery, reported that one or both of the men had been castrated. Some said Roger Malcolm's genitals had been stuffed into his mouth. Some said the woman's genitals had been carved out and tossed up into the trees by the Apalachee River. And others said that one or both of the women had been pregnant and that their babies had been ripped from their wombs and murdered too. There was no proof of these things. Neither the newsmen who reported on the viewing nor Dan Young in his comments to others said anything about castration or pregnancy. Yet those who told the stories and those who listened to them didn't need proof. The history of lynching made the stories believable if they weren't true. Other people walked out of the Young funeral home that day with unanswered questions. When did Roger and Dorothy and George and May sense they were in danger? Was it when Loy Harrison turned off the highway, or not until they neared the Moore's Ford Bridge? Did Roger and George try to fight off the lynchers? Were they able to hurt any of them? Did they try to break free and escape, or did they think the white men were only going to beat them? Did they scream when they realized all was lost, or did they go silent? Did they die instantly, or at least quickly? Did they die with knowledge of why they were lynched? Still others walked out of the funeral home laughing bitterly. There were so many holes you could see daylight through the bodies, they said. Their faces were like screams. You could sift flour through them. This gallows humor served to take in shock, to mask surprise and fear and anger. As one black reporter noted, some people on the corner that day were as loudmouthed and hilarious as if the stark tragedy had never occurred. Indeed, life went on in a fashion. Briggery's Cafe, where Dorothy Malcolm and Mae Murray had purchased their penny candy 2 days before, was doing a brisk business on soda pop, pork chops, and fish sandwiches. The beauty parlor and barbershop were full along the road that led from the corner up to the paved main street. Groups of black veterans, still wearing khaki shirts and army fatigue caps, played checkers. Though the reporter described them as loudmouthed and hilarious, from a distance they quickly turned somber when he approached with questions about their experiences since returning from the army. I'll stop there. There were so many portions in there, I felt like I needed to include it for context. I could probably ask about five different questions. I'll start number one. There were many sections in the book where I said, wow, I have a white woman who's writing this book. I'll even pause and get in a mini question. Since there is a system of racism, white supremacy, we agreed there. Do you think it's logical for any non-white person, myself included, to suspect you of being racist? You're classified as white. Do you think that's logical to have suspicions?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So reading the portion that I just read, that's one of many moments where I said, wow, we have a white woman who I suspect could be a racist writing all of this. How do I feel about this coming from the perspective of a white woman? So question one, just from this section, would be, did you have any concerns or feel like, wow, maybe I should not be the one to author this story?
I did think about it, and then I talked about it with people and different variety of different people, and I wanted to be of service. I wanted to do the research. I had these skills. I had, you know, this education and this kind of research and reporting. Because I was white, I could talk to people that probably would not have talked to a black person, in Walton County and Oconee County. So I wanted to use my privilege to do something useful, and this is what I did.
Did any of the black people or any non-white people that you talked to, did any of them say, maybe you shouldn't, maybe you can do this research and help a black person? Did any of them tell you that they didn't think it would be constructive for you to write this?
No, it was a little bit of a different moment. This was in the late 90s, early 2000s.
I think it'd be more
likely to happen today. But no, that didn't happen.
Okay. Sticking with the same portion, this portion and even the other segment that I read the first time that I mentioned Delectable Negro, kind of going over some of the details of what happened to these victims. I have concluded, and it's Delectable Negro, Vincent Woodard, that's kind of the conclusion there as well, that the system of white supremacy, individuals classified as white, they enjoy practicing racism. Racist jokes, a lot of times the punchline involves violence against black people especially. That suggests there's something enjoyable, humorous about violence, fatal violence often, against black people. The lynching, you asked, have I seen the Without Sanctuary exhibit? Yes, ma'am. When I was a resident in Atlanta, it was at the King Center. And I think within the first few days of me moving to Atlanta, that was one of the first things I did. I went to the King Center. I saw the exhibit. But that whole exhibit makes my point in terms of enjoying violence against the black people. Why would a postcard, hey, I have a photograph of when we lynched and castrated the Negro. This would make a great postcard. You have that all throughout the book. We couldn't get lynching souvenirs, so we'll have to settle for photographs with the Negro. that suggests that there's an enjoyment of consuming black bodies. So I would think that there might even be an enjoyment of just reading this type of literature to hear, oh, wow, we can't participate in an actual lynching, but we can consume mm-hmm. the details as though we were there. Does that make sense? And do you think that also could be happening?
I guess that could be. I have to be honest, I never thought about it. I mean, when I decided to include these details, it was in the interest of being truthful and of telling its full story about the horrors that were committed. But I do see what you're saying, that that's a possibility that this could be, that this could be pleasurable for somebody. I do see that. I do see that possibility. Yeah.
Let's see. I was going to say more about the response of the black people at the funeral, but I'll pause because I said I was going to get questions from listeners. The number is 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. Thomas in New York, did you have a question for Miss Laura Wexler? You should be with us. Thomas in New York.
Good evening, Miss Wexler. How you doing? Good evening, Gus.
Greetings.
Hi.
How you doing? I would like to ask you, do you consider yourself a good white person?
I try to be, yeah.
What's your definition of a bad white person, or what constitutes a bad white person if you're a good white person?
Oh, goodness. I mean, I think there's a range of them, but I guess I would say people who would commit a lynching, for example.
Okay. Interesting. Are you a white supremacist?
I mean, I try not to be. I've certainly grown up in a society based on white supremacy, so it's a constant effort to critique and challenge the ways in which those ideas have shaped me. So that's it's a constant effort not to be.
All right. So what would be the meaning behind being a white person in a system of white supremacy?
I'm not sure I understand your question.
But I'll move on. How much of white supremacy racism is based off of the fact that the end result of a sexual relationship in which the child is born, the child is generally a non-white child? How much of the system do you think is perpetuated because of that?
I'm sorry, is this related to the book I wrote about?
You started the book off talking about an interracial relationship, am I right?
Oh, yes, uh-huh, yes. Purported in interracial relationship, yes. So, okay, ask your question. Now I know what you're talking about. Okay, can you ask me again?
The end result of an interracial relationship, generally the child that will come, the end product, will be a non-white child. Do you think that is what is perpetuating the system of racism, white supremacy, that white men or women who have sex with non-white people cannot have reproduce a white child as a result of that union?
I apologize. I don't understand how to respond to your question. So I'm just gonna. I guess the one thing I would say is there was not a child produced in the relationship that I wrote about in
general,
the beginning.
In general, though, I'm sure the people who were lynching or shooting the person, they understood that, you know, the end result of this relationship would be a non-white child. Do you think that is one of the driving catalysts behind the psyche of what continues to let white supremacy and racism exist. If not, if you can't answer, that's fine, Gus. You could move on. Thank you for taking my call.
I'm sorry. I wish I could. I'm not qualified to answer that. I don't entirely understand the question still. So.
Okay. That question did remind me, the tragic arrangement, sexual intercourse between white people and black people, the Adams family, some of the black people, mm-hmm. that was another moment where I said, a white author writing this. Some of the black people said, hey, George Dorsey got what he deserved. Roger Malcolm got what he deserved. Dorothy, she got what she deserved because they were low class black people. They were low class Negros. Dorothy was sleeping with white people, white men, and, you know, whatever. I knew something bad was going to happen. And they said that George Dorsey, he was messing around with those white men. He was hanging around at the Adams, with the Adams girls. He was hanging out too close with them. I could see something bad was going to happen. And that's what happened. If they got lynched, oh, well, got what he deserved. I thought it was curious when you talk, not that I hadn't heard all that before. Yes, every black person is a rapist, black males. But what I did find interesting was the Adams father, the patriarch, he commits suicide. And you wrote in the book that some of the folks said that was not suicide. That they said maybe he was committing suicide because he wasn't doing right as a white father to keep his white daughters away from the black guys. But some of the other folks, some of the black people said, we think the Klan killed him because he wasn't doing right. You know, white people do not tolerate you not keeping your children, your white daughters in line and letting them be reckless with black males. Maybe even going to Thomas in New York's question. Do you think it's possible that the Adams father, that he could have been a victim of Klan violence for not keeping his daughters in line?
Possible, yes. Yep.
Wow. Are you aware of other cases where there was racist violence against a white person or a white father or a white parent because of what they were or weren't doing with their children?
I can't name one, but I know that there was, you know, that it was the sense that he couldn't control his daughter, keep her from, you know, fraternizing in ways that the Klan prohibited. It doesn't strike me as that surprising that there would be some punishment for that. And also, I mean, again, there was, I think it's possible. I do think it's possible. That was I went down the rabbit hole of the death of George Adams for a long time, trying to come out clearly on one side or the other. And like a lot of things in this case, you end up with more questions than answers. But I do think it's possible.
168, the paragraph, when George Adams was found hanging in the Woodhouse on the Fannie Wright Place on that morning in February 1946, the black people who lived near Loy Harrison's farm assumed, like many of the whites, that he died because of his daughter's promiscuity, but they didn't believe it was suicide. They'd heard of the Ku Klux Klan killing sorry white people, in quotes, before, and they believed a group of white men, members of the Klan or sympathizers with its cause, had killed George Adams because he'd allowed his daughters to have sex with black men. You know they mad when they get mad with the girl's daddy, says Roy Jackson. You know that man didn't kill himself. That was a new one on Gus T. I had not heard about that before, but wow. She thinks it's possible. Let's see. Retired firefighter in Florida. If you had a question for Laura Wexler, author of Fire in a Canebrake, you should be with us. Proceed. Oh, I'm a little light. There you go. Proceed.
Yes, sir. Greetings, Gus. Greetings to the guests. Greetings to everybody on the line. To the guests, I heard that she identified themselves as a good white person. I wouldn't doubt it.
Trying to be good white person.
Oh, now it's to trying to be? Okay. All right.
Yeah, well, no, I was saying I try to be, yes. Still.
In my research of you, being that you were a total stranger to me, also I would like to just mention that it is my place to challenge you in regards of sincerity and honesty. So hopefully everything will work out. But in my research of you, being that I didn't know you, I saw the term feminist associated with your name. Would that be an accurate distinction?
You mean, am I a feminist?
That could be something that you can answer. And if so, what is a, when you say feminist, because I don't use the word myself, what do you mean when you say the word feminist associated with yourself?
Okay, well, what I think, okay, so let me say there's another Laura Wexler, who's a writer, and she is a professor of feminist studies at Yale. So that you may have turned up her if you were doing some internet searching, because I don't know that I like have written anywhere that I identify as a feminist, but in fact I do. So I'm not
okay. Well, okay. Well, you answered the question. Do you seek attention from non-white people as a result of your investigation, your book?
Do I seek attention from non-white people as a result of my book? I don't think so. I mean, I wrote the book over 10 years, and it came out in 2003, so it's like 16 years old now, and I don't publicize it or really do anything, although last month I did go to Atlanta to participate in a suit against the federal government to see if we can get the grand jury transcripts unsealed so we can see what happened in those 3 weeks when all these witnesses came and then no one was indicted. But otherwise, I don't, like, promote the book or anything like that. I'm not sure if this is your question.
Yes. You may have answered it or not, but my second question is, what is your motivation for your attention placed on the Maud Ford lynching?
Well, I mean, my first motivation was to find out what happened and to put all the pieces together in a book so that other people could know that this happened. It wasn't very well known outside, really, of like Southern history. So I really wanted to try to bring some attention to this and learn it for myself and then bring attention to it. You know, I was hoping that maybe in interviewing people and researching it, I could actually find some evidence that would lead to a conviction, and that didn't happen. I don't think that will happen, but that was also part of my motivation.
Okay, my next to the last question is not really that significant, but I was just curious. Are you related to Jerry Wexler? And if so, in what way?
No, I don't know who that is.
He was known as a person who controlled a lot of black entertainers. He died...
Yeah.
Like Aretha Franklin, Ray Charles, there was a Hall of Fame list of black entertainers that he controlled.
Yeah, I just Googled him right now. Oh, I see who he is. No, I'm not related to him, but that is interesting to know about him.
Okay, last but not least, what is your answer to solving the problem of racism, white supremacy, which you, from my understanding, you acknowledge the host question on the subject early in the program. What is your answer we would like to know what is your answer to solving the problem of racism and white supremacy.
That's a really fair question. I don't have a good answer. I mean, I guess my own personal my own personal action is to educate, investigate, research, and try to understand, and then publish my findings. But I wouldn't say that that's the answer with a capital A. It's what I've found I can do and have the skills for.
Well, that's what we are foremost interested in as victims of racism, and we should also would want anybody who is able to work towards solving the problem is to have a means, a personal means themselves to solving the problem, or their sincerity should be challenged. You think that's a correct statement?
I think it's fair. I think that's a fair statement.
You use the term fair twice, but I'll just end my my questions to and Gus probably would speak on the use of that term. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. Let's see. I had to get some of the other folks who dialed in. I just wanted to read a quick passage. This is on 123. Let's see. Bottom of 122, just for full context. Going back to what I said before about how it can be true that white people are not ignorant, and they're still deceptive about these events. As agents fanned out to interview the rest of the Hester clan, brothers-in-law, cousins by marriage, and distant relations, they began to hear the same phrases again and again, like a chorus. I have never been to Moore's Ford. Don't even know where it is. I was not around Monroe that day. I have no idea who killed the Negroes, probably niggers. Certainly, lying, there it is, was a defense mechanism and an evasion strategy, but it quickly became sport as well. Just as bootleggers had long been revered for outsmarting federal revenuers, locals soon earned respect for ridiculing or lying to the FBI. More than one white man duped agents into believing he was working for them as a confidential informant when he was really aiding suspects by alerting them of agents' plans. Although the FBI and GBI, Georgia Bureau of Investigation, agents were Southern white men with accents to match, they were outsiders. Most people in Walton County had never seen an FBI agent before, except in the movies, and against the outside threat, the locals constructed a wall of silence or an iron curtain, as FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover would later say. This wall was built from both solidarity and fear of reprisal, as one white man in Hestertown said, "If I had anything to do with the lynching and my brother reported it, I'd kill him." Within a week of the lynching, agents concluded in their report that the people of Hestertown, almost without exception, had indicated in some way that they resented the entire investigation. Many had admitted that they do not wish to see anyone punished for the crime. Others have stated that they are opposed to the mass killings, but have said they would not furnish information that might lead to a solution of the crime if they had such information in their possession. Indeed, resistance to agents' efforts was so clearly the norm in Hestertown that when a white person did appear willing to aid the investigation, agents automatically became suspicious. I thought that was a fantastic indictment of what it means to be white. Lockstep commitment. But I also thought this is a great response to what I said before about, I don't think there's any confusion about what happened. There might be some tidbits here and there, but I think white people are just lying about these events and are content to do so. But it doesn't seem, if they have people that are lying to the FBI agents, saying, oh yeah, I'm working with you, I'm an informant, and then they go back and tell the suspects that would seem like you probably have a good idea of who would need this information to make sure that they keep themselves quiet or toss away any potential evidence, that sort of thing. Like, I think they just do a really good job of lying about things. Am I being inaccurate?
No, I think that's certainly true for this passage. When I talked about the people misremembering, I was talking about like wives of these guys, and, you know, 50 years on, and, you know, you tell yourself a lie long enough and you believe it. And then the lies become interesting, and why are they constructed that way? And how do they support a story that you're living by? So, but yeah, absolutely. I mean, they wall of silence, iron curtain, all of that. Yep, that was built on, those were built on lies for sure.
Caller in Louisiana, Irie, did you have a question for Ms. Wexler? You should be with us.
Yes, good evening. I want to ask it, and well, I hope you're doing good this evening. Thank you for joining. I have a three-part question, so that way I can just wrap it up. First part is, how much money did you make from this publication? Second part of the question is, what exactly does it mean for you to be a plaintiff in this case? And forgive me if you answered that already. I came in a little bit late on the call. What is the legal, what does that mean legally? And then the last part of the question is, are you prepared to defend your safety and life in the event that there is some convictions or a conviction in regard to this case? Thank you, and I'll meet the line.
Thanks for your questions. I'll take them in reverse order. So I don't fear for my safety with regard to any kind of backlash from convictions in this. I don't live in this area anymore. I don't live in Georgia. And when I did, and I was working on the book in the late 90s and early 2000s, I sometimes felt like a little bit intimidated, but I still wouldn't say I ever felt threatened. I mean, most of the people that I was talking to and dealing with were older, and I always felt like I could outrun them if there were a problem. But I don't really fear for that. Maybe that's stupid, but I'm being honest and saying I don't. What in terms of the court case now? So, I am really an understudy for the original plaintiff in this case. So I wrote this book. It came out in 2003, and then in maybe 2017-16, another writer named Anthony Pitch started researching a book on the same case. And while he was doing research in the National Archives, he discovered, much to his surprise and all the archivists, he discovered the grand jury transcripts from this case. Nobody thought that they existed, number one. But number two, there's a, by federal law, grand jury transcripts are sealed in cases where there are no indictments. And so once he found the transcripts, he couldn't look at them according to federal law. And so he had a friend who was a lawyer, and he asked the lawyer, are there ever exceptions to this case where courts rule that exceptions to this rule where courts make an exception that that unseals the grand jury transcripts. And there have been cases where that's happened. And so the lawyer said, we can try. And so they started in the lower courts, and they kept winning, and they got to the 11th Circuit Court, which is the middle district of Georgia and Alabama. Anyway, and Anthony Pitch died this summer before this hearing. And he was a plaintiff in the case, and now they needed another plaintiff. And so they reached out to me, and I said it would absolutely be my honor to do this. And so I am named as a plaintiff on the case, and the hearing was held in Atlanta in October, and it was a hearing with all of the justices from the circuit list were in attendance, and we should have a decision in January or February. One of the things that came up at the hearing was that a suggestion by Justice Wilson that the unsealing of the grand jury transcripts be pursued through the Cold Case Records Act, which is a new act that was passed last year that provides for a kind of speedier and more efficient release of civil rights cold case materials than normally you would do through FOIA or through this. But the problem is that they probably won't deal with grand jury transcripts. So I think it's still going to come down to the courts. And if the court decides that they won't unseal the transcripts, it will be appealed and it may go to the Supreme Court. So that's the situation with being a plaintiff on the hearing. In terms of your first question, which is how much money did I earn for the book? So in 1997, when I got an advance for the book, I was paid $45,000. And that is the sum total of what I've earned on the book. That was for 4 years of work. So, and I think I answered all three of her questions, if I'm keeping score correctly.
Awesome. Let's see. 9029. Did you have a question?
Yes, Gus. Greetings to the guests, Ms. Wexler. Greetings, Gus, listeners, and callers. Just a few questions. Since you've been doing this research, have you been treated different by other white people, especially family members? Has this occurred?
No. Everybody that I know has been supportive of this.
Wow. Has doing this work and gaining more knowledge about these terrorist acts made you look at other white people in some type of disgust or confused in some manner, like in regards to their actions or anything?
Yes, but also to be suspicious of systems, right? Systems can seem neutral, but to really look in the way in which it's a system that, allows for something like a lynching to happen and then also provides the mechanism through which it can be covered up and never brought to justice.
Has this occurred, has any situations occurred also where you've practiced racism and you catch yourself or you see somebody around you practice it and you stop them from doing it in any form or fashion?
I mean, I'm constantly trying to critique, myself and be aware of what I've, how I've been shaped by the racist system that I grew up in, right, in America, and by the privilege that I've, been extended as a white person. So it's like my constant MO, modus operandi, is to try to be aware of that and check it and, be vigilant for it. Absolutely, yeah.
Okay. The word privilege, we kind of, on the show, we tend to try to steer away from that because of the connotation. It kind of gives the idea that it's something small and minute. But as you can tell from most of your reading and your work, that for a white woman having for a white woman to have the privilege to call out a black man for doing something he didn't do, is not really privilege. It's more like a power, and it's more like a terrorist act. So we kind of tend to steer away from that word. Just a bit of insight. But who do you think is more confused about racism as well? Do you think white people are more confused or non-white people?
White people, for sure.
Oh, wow. So based on your research, you think the white people that you've been studying...
You mean confused areas, if they are confused about what racism is? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, well, confused about the whole structure, as you said very well before.
Yeah, because I think it's blind. I think it can be blind to you if you exist within it and profit from it. You just think it's normal, right? You just think it's neutral. You just think everybody has an equal chance. You know, we all have equal rights, blah, 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 blah. So
I have to, I think I understand what you're saying, but I do have to disagree with you on that. I meet countless white people who are fully aware of what's going on, and they're complicit in it, deeply complicit in it. But those are all the questions I have. Thank you. Thank you for your time and energy. And you spoke about, don't want to take up too much time, but you spoke about a documentary, or was this a movie? And I wanted to kind of get an idea why I didn't get a chance to write that down when you spoke about that before that you're working on.
Oh, well, it's a script that I'm writing, but it's not, nothing's happened with it yet. So there's nowhere to see it.
I think it was a case. I think you, that.
The case is a true story. It's called the Rhinelander case. Rhinelander, the Rhinelander affair. If you Google that, you'll find some information about the case. Yeah, it's really interesting one.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you again for your time and energy.
Sure, my pleasure.
The caller at 0747-0747. Do you have a question for Ms. Wex?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Evening, Gus, and callers, listeners, and Professor Wexler. In the text, you were discussing the jury, the federal jury trial, and you said, and I read, the jurors were obviously less concerned with Monroe's national reputation than with maintaining the system of white supremacy. Would it also be accurate to say with maintaining the global system of white supremacy, meaning that it's not just Monroe County or Georgia, it's also Baltimore, Cleveland, South Africa, Europe, Canada, et cetera?
That jurors are concerned with maintaining that system?
Yes, the global system. Because I think one of the things that's always emphasized is that this is a system down south in Georgia, which I don't think is accurate.
Well, I was writing about a case in Georgia, so I was keeping my comments, specific to that.
But you do agree it's a global system.
Yeah, sure. I do agree. Yeah, I can't speak as knowledgeably or articulately about the global situation as I can about this. I wish I could, but I'd be dishonest if I said I had that, had the same level of credibility to do that.
But you did live in Baltimore, for example.
I do live in Baltimore. I do, yes.
Right. I think so my second question is, in the text you say the consul, you were talking about, there's no federal law against lynching in the United States today. The consolation is that lynching generally declined in the years following 1946, a result of the rise of black political power. could you expound on that in terms of what you meant by black political power?
What page is that on?
That's on 204, bottom of 204, top of 205.
Okay. It's ringing a bell, but this has been, it's been a minute here. Let's see.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, I list that as one of the reasons, right? A result of the rise of black political power, the transformation of the South from agrarian to industrial, the lessening of isolation, increasing knowledge that they were faced, that lynchers would face investigation. Rise of black political power. Yeah. I'm not sure what I meant by that, to be honest.
Because, you know, one of the things we discuss on this program, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but that in a global system of racism, white supremacy, that you can't have black political power.
Yeah, I mean, this has been a long time. I'm not sure what I was thinking at the time. I mean, the other reason seems stronger to me at this moment. So I'm sorry, I can't give you a satisfying answer.
Oh, that's fine. And my last question is, you talk a little bit about at the end of your book, about the descendants of these terrorizing criminals. Do you consider the descendants of these perpetrators victims?
Do I consider them victims? Interesting. No.
Okay.
No, they're not victims. No, they're not victims, but by the same token, I wouldn't put them in the same category as the lynchers themselves.
Okay. I don't have any more questions. Thank you, Gus.
Much obliged. Imhan Deesey, I was going to ask that about the victims as well. Great reading. I was going to ask that as well. Imhan Deesey, if you had a question, proceed.
Yes, sir. Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. My question, can you give me your definition of white supremacy?
Oh, my gosh. You know, I really can't speak like in an educated way to a definition of white supremacy. In fact, I mean, except to say it's a system in which, you know, white people have power and, you know, create mechanisms to maintain and consolidate that power. But I'm still thinking about what Gus said at the beginning, defining with his definition. And that's sort of the best I can do right now. I hope that's somewhat articulate, but.
Okay. My next question is, white people in America, are they from America?
White people in America, are they from America? No, nobody is from here.
Nobody's from America?
I mean, most people are immigrants to America.
Are white people from Africa?
I mean, some are. I'm not sure. I feel like you're getting to a point here, and it's mysterious to me.
You said white people are from Africa, but you don't know. You don't want to continue answering my questions because I'm getting.
Oh,
to a
keep
point
going. I'm curious. I guess this is mysterious to me where this is leading, but.
Where are white people from? Where are white people indigenous to?
I don't know. Why don't you tell me?
I'm not a white person, and I don't have access to all the historical evidence. I think your study might be history. And are you saying that you don't know where your people, white people, are from? You know that they're not from America, but you don't know.
I mean, my people are from. I mean, I can tell you where my family is from: Russia, and all the way back Norway. So that's where we are from. White people from a lot of different places. I can't tell you where the first white person was born. I don't know that. I honestly, what I'm really happy to talk about is this book or this case.
Oh, it's related to this book. I can continue and make it related to the book.
Okay.
So you're talking about a lot of things that were happening. You were speaking about a lot of things that are happening in America that white people are doing. You spoke very, very graphically. Your book speaks very, very graphically about the killings that the murders white people commit, the rapings that white people commit, the genocides that white people commit in this country, America, but they've done it in all the other countries too. And so my question is, white people in America, did they come here as an invasion?
I'm just going to go back to what I feel comfortable talking about is this case and this book. It's not that I don't want to answer your question. It's that I literally have nothing intelligent to say about it.
No, you do have something intelligent to say about it. You're a white person who is from the group of people who have made it to America. And now, would the murders of black people in America occur if white people were not in America?
You know what? I really appreciate your questions. I feel absolutely unqualified to answer them.
No. This isn't a qualification question. Would white people be killing black people in America if white people were not in America?
Well, I guess they would not. No, because they would not be here.
So my question is to the legitimacy of white people being here. Are they supposed to be here? That's why I asked, is it an invasion? Because now we can talk about war crimes. You understand, if you're not from here and you've come here and now you're committing all the crimes now that you're here and you're doing it generationally.
It's definitely related
to your book because it's related to your book. And this isn't something difficult to understand. White people commit the crimes now that they're here, but they're not supposed to be here. So then my question was, have white people come here in an invasion? The way that they got here, was it an invasion?
I have to think about that. I cannot say I've ever thought about it in exactly those terms before.
But when they came here, they committed genocide. Is that not what an invasion is?
I mean, I guess we could have a conversation about whether there are invasions that don't include genocide and whether there's genocide that's not related to an invasion. I think we could have a long conversation about that, but again, I'm not the person qualified to do that.
You are the person. You're the exact person.
And well, so my question, I thank you for your faith in me, but I don't share it.
Okay. So my last question. Can we end white supremacy by white people leaving from America?
Interesting. I don't know.
Oh, this is still the same question. You said you don't know if white supremacy would end if white people left. If white people left America, you wouldn't know if that ended, if white supremacy would end. But how would you be able to implement your power over the people if you're not here?
Well, it would be a question of whether the system would remain.
What system?
of white supremacy. So I would argue white supremacy is a system.
Right. Can white supremacy still exist if there's no white people?
I don't know. That's a really good question that I'm chewing on right now.
That's my last question. Thank you.
Much obliged, Imhun DC. I will get in my last two questions, and then we will let Miss Wexler enjoy the rest of her Monday evening. Sid Chu, again, delectable Negro. You did an interview with NPR way back closer to the time when your book was first published in 2003. And you all were talking about some of the media attention that was generated around this case back at 1946. And they read one of the reports. And I get to mention the book again. Chu, delectable Negro. Human Consumption and Homoeroticism in U.S. Slave Culture, Vincent Woodard, published in 2014. But the paragraph from the report, it reads, this is what the anchor said. 140 million Americans were disgraced late yesterday, humiliated in their own eyes and in the eyes of the world by one of the most vicious lynchings to stain our national record, a gang of armed and degenerate poor whites waylaid a Negro man and another man with their wives on a country road 40 miles from Atlanta. The brief and sadistic orgy ended in the bodies being riddled by 60 bullets. In the word orgy, a wild party, especially one involving excessive drinking, which there was, and unrestrained sexual activity. He had a reputation for drunken orgies. Is that correct term usage, orgy, to describe what happened at Moore's Ford Bridge?
What page are you on?
Well, this is from a report. This is not your writing. This is from a report of the Moore's Ford Bridge lynching from NPR News. I can read you exactly from the report, but they used the term orgy. It's from a news report from 1946, in fact, and they used the term. So is the question was, is that correct usage of the term for what happened at Moore's Forge Bridge, orgy?
I think they were using it not in the sexual sense, but in the sense of an unrestrained, like, primal killing spree. In that sense, yes.
You don't think there was any sexual connotation to what was happening at Moore's Ford Bridge?
In the moment there, I don't think that was the prevailing. I don't think that was the prevailing sentiment. Not that it was a 0% factor, but I think, you know, I don't think that was. I think it was shooting people and the kind of group mob killing and a kind of like orgy of violence. Yes, I do think that's a correct phraseology.
In the book, you reported that this was not a, this was a shooting. It was still lynching, but this was a shooting. However, in the book, you reported that Roger Malcolm allegedly had ropes around his hands. There are reports that he was tortured. There was ire about that stabbing. And, you know, people were upset about this black male potentially killing a white man. If he was tortured at all, standing over the bodies and gloating about this with an alcoholic beverage, you don't think any of that constitutes sexual gratification?
You know what? It could be. I thought you were asking more in like a more narrowly defined sense of the word, but I can see what you're saying. Yeah, absolutely.
That can be one that you on as well. That is a major theme in Delectable Negro, that these acts of lynching, which frequently involve disrobing black people, don't know if that happened here or not, but you did. I mean, that is in the book, that Roger Malcolm, you know, had a rope around him, that he may have been tortured, receiving more punishment than some of the others. That is one of the major themes in Delectable Negro, that these lynchings, these mass killings, should be looked at as a form of sexual gratification. They frequently involve sexual mutilation, castration, in some instances, that, yeah, maybe we should start to re-examine how we think about these events. But they did use the term orgy, and this is from the day it's even used in the NPR report. This is a Q&A interview from 2006, and this is just from one of the news clippings of the day where they used that term orgy, and that's implied in the term. My last question, did you grow up in the Georgia area, or did you just go to college at UGA?
No, I didn't even go to college there. I just worked there.
Just worked there. Okay, where did you grow up?
Baltimore.
Baltimore. Oh, wow. Rat and rodent infested mess. My goodness. Can't believe it. Been there all that time. Poor thing. I should ask anyway, because you're still white. Did you hear any racist jokes about black people? Have you heard, been around white people who tell racist jokes about black people?
You mean like when I was growing up, or
at any time, at
or...
any time in life, at any time in life?
I'm sure I did, but I can't tell you a single instance of that I recall specifically or vividly. Okay. I really can't.
That is another question I try to ask white people. We've had many white people on. We've had some who literally, who were like born in areas like Georgia, North Carolina, especially if you have a white person who's older, like over 55, 60. Oh man. Oh, we've literally had some white people said, I've heard 1,000. I've heard more than 1,000 of them, but they all, about 99.8% of them will say the same thing. I can't remember one. I've heard 500. I've heard dozens of them. Oh yeah, we used to tell them all the time, family, relatives. Because then the reason that I ask is, as I said before, the punchlines. You'll see the violent. Just interrogate racist jokes. We talk so much about white lying. That is one of the few times when they're being honest about racism and about their thoughts about black people. Deconstruct racist jokes. They say so much.
Interesting.
We will let you get to the rest of your Monday evening. The book we have discussed, Fire in a Canebrake, The Last Mass Lynching in America. Now we can all pay attention moving forward. If they unseal the transcripts, maybe we'll get to see what they were talking about from the grand jury, see if there's any constructive information, but we'll all be a little bit more mindful moving forward. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your time to speak with us. Enjoyed reading the book and getting more information about this incident of terrorism.
Thank you. Thanks for your questions and for all the callers' questions. It was really an illuminating experience.
Much obliged. Again, author of Fire in a Canebrake. She survived Baltimore, Maryland. Incredible. Joining us live, Laura Wexler. Thank you so much for being with us, and we will speak with you soon.
Okay, my pleasure. Take care.
Good evening. Context of White Supremacy. Wow. Reading is more important than watching television. Fire in a Canebrake. I don't remember if I even heard of this book when I first heard about the case, that there were, you know, information. You could go and dig a little more, get more information about the text. A couple quick thoughts and then we'll hear from listeners. Let's see. I thought it was significant when she was saying she was inarticulate when I first brought up Delectable Negro, white consumption. Why? What would motivate white people to go out and collect a black person's teeth to give to their girlfriend for a charm bracelet? What would motivate hordes, dozens of whites all over, not just in one area, to go out and do this, for generations to do this and keep a black, you know, got, that's, you know, Jamal's knuckles, got them in a jar back there, been keeping them for the last 15 years, one of my prized possessions. What would, you know, motivate such behavior? But she said she was inarticulate. This is someone who is a paid writer. Thousands of dollars for this here book. Let's see. Don't help with the answer. I thought that was so important. The caller read the book, did all that research and everything, prepared, and asked about black political power. And she said, I don't know what I meant there, which is the truth. That is accurate in a system of racism, white supremacy. Like, what does that even mean? That's an oxymoron, black political power. She said, I don't know what it meant. Don't help them with the answer. White people are not ignorant. A lot of times when I explore, really, all the time, when I explain concepts on the program, I'm explaining for non-white listeners. And I often will make that clear that I'm not explaining for the white person. I'm explaining for the victims who are listening. Do not help them with the answer when you ask a question. And certainly do not, you know, hop in to share counter-racist logic on particular. I wanted to hear her talk more, just if she was going to say, I don't know what I was thinking. How did I even come up with a phrase like that? Black people. I was waiting and then it got, whoo, yeah, do not help white people with the answer. I'm sure I'm not always the best at that, but that is why I use my mute button too. That way I, you know, cannot do it. Don't help with the answer. when she, at the very beginning of the program, so important, give my definition of white supremacy racism, and she asked to hear it twice. When I gave it, she said, before she even commented on the definition, she said, wait a minute, I just want to make sure I'm not agreeing with that definition, because I said I'm white. I want to make sure I'm not agreeing to saying that I'm a racist. Even though she said repeatedly throughout the program that she is trying to be a good white person, meaning she's not there yet, anyway, but immediately. And I thought that was important because following the logic, the question I ask regularly, what does it mean to be white? Following the logic in the system of white supremacy, it's real simple. It's seconds. That question, the answer to that question, in my view, what does it mean to be white, is why she didn't say she was a good white person. She said she was trying to be a good white person. And we have a program, Zach Casey, admitted white supremacist. He said there is no such thing as a good white person. Why? What does it mean to be white? 2000, what have we been doing for a decade in the archives? 2000 at the White Privilege Conference, no less. At the white, not the White Power Conference, the White Privilege Conference. Zach Casey, impossible good white person. Anyway, if folks have any thoughts, things that stood out, they learned anything, 605-313-5164. Decode 564-943-pound. White ignorance is such a common theme. You have to really be vigilant about that and push back, because it'll be consistent. Everything will just be reduced to white ignorance. That is not logical at all, in any aspect. And the refusal or inability to just white people lie. They'll come up with a lot of fascinating terms to move away from white people lie. They practice racism. They lie. Period. And I thought it was great. Last thing. This book starts with a black male counter violence. Yes, he gets lynched. Of course, we've not solved the problem. But another illustration, you did not have solely black cowards who never fought back and just, you know, accepted whatever torment and abuse whites chose to dole out. There are lots and lots and lots of illustrations of black people fighting back, including counterviolence, including killing white people, even present day, 21st century, lots of examples. This would be another. I will pause there. If folks have commentary, proceed.
Can I be heard?
Retired firefighter?
Yes. I thought it was important for me to, and logical, of course, to ask on what is her answer to solving this problem. Because logically speaking, what would be your motivation? And apparently, I think I may have heard her motivation since she didn't have an answer to my prior question that I stated about her answer to solving the problem of race with white supremacy. I actually held a number in my head about how much she was compensated for, and it was much more than what I expected. But I'm not surprised, being it was a white person, and they were talking about racism, white supremacy, $40,000 for a book. But anyway, apparently that's some motivation. She didn't return it, and she didn't act. She didn't state anything about that. She gave it to black organization like the DCS program, anything like that. So she probably purchased a vehicle or something for it. And at the same time, she had no fear of her life in the process. So it's like a jubilee for white people who would speak on or write on racism, the great amount of acknowledgement, except for this program and a few more that I would rather think about that would not give her acknowledgement on the subject. But nevertheless, we are an exception, I would say in most cases, unfortunately. People, including non-white people, would acknowledge her out of nowhere. A red carpet would come out, she would be very much acknowledged as some sort of hero or something. Let me see what else. That's why I kind of like approach with intrepidation my questions about the term feminist, because I wasn't sure if I was reporting on the correct person. That's why I asked on it, does she have that next to her name, because I was prepared to ask her questions about the relationship with white women have with non-white females who are racially classified as black females, being that two in this particular case were murdered. What about present situations? You're talking about a cold case that probably is not going to get recognized. What about the present day situation of black females being mistreated that gets reported anyway on a daily basis? And what are you, how active are you in subject matters concerning with black females that are being mistreated due to the system of racist white supremacy? And that those are some of my thoughts while I was just listening. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. Other folks who are with us, if you have a question or comment, proceed.
Hello.
Irie.
Yes, I am back. I want to apologize to the remaining callers and listeners for the first part of my question. It should have been, how much money have you made from the publication and subsequent lectures, which would have been more revealing. Even though she gave the amount that they you know, advanced her. There's still no telling or saying what she's made from any other. I don't know. She could be lying. I just don't trust that 40,000 is the full amount from that publication. I don't know any people that call themselves white to do anything so in depth. For to me, I would think that would be a small amount. I just don't. Doesn't sound right. And what was I going to say? I also did notice, I'm sure as everyone else did, that she probably wouldn't write a book like this if she lived in Georgia, you know, because she too would possibly be subject to white sacrifice confusion for betraying her her kind. And I'm sorry, betraying. What else was I going to say? And I also do applaud Ilhan DC for his thorough questioning, because ultimately, these are not necessarily, I don't know if I would put it as war crimes, because, you know, we're not fully functional to commit counter war, but I would definitely call them crimes against humanity and nature. Because, yes, they were invaders, are invaders, and commit human atrocities and continuous genocide to maintain a position of power. And I think this is another display of necrophilia, and, you know, kind of like, I guess, I don't know, is it okay to use a metaphor, Gus?
Yes, ma'am.
So for me, it reminded me of her book and this, you know, display of, oh, look what we did. It's definitely to me for white people, and it reminds me of when a person goes to a psychic or a tarot card reader, and the tarot card reader gets paid to tell the person what they know already, that they're a terrorist or a racist terrorist in this instance. So that's all. Again, I apologize for that. And I'll mute my line. Thank you, Gus, and everybody on the line.
I'm sure if she has not received speaking engagement already, which I suspect she has, she will be moving forward as, you know, this case is talked about. And, you know, if they open up the transcript from the grand jury testimony and that sort of thing, I'm sure she'll get more speaking engagements and the like. So, yeah, I'm sure she will be getting more attention. She'll be the expert, resident expert on the case. Other folks have comments, questions?
May I be heard?
Yes, sir.
There were a couple of things I was kind of surprised about. Since she's been doing this work, the people that are around her that are white, mainly family members, she hasn't been treated any different for doing this type of work. I find that so hard to believe. Anytime I've questioned white people in regards to any kind of counter-racist conversations they've ever had with other white people, they always get extreme pushback. So in this case where she's doing all this research, like, nobody in her family is saying anything, no close friends or relatives or giving her any so-called flack for this, I was kind of surprised. And the other thing, and the other aspect that you already pretty much qualified it when you spoke to her and asked her what she feels about white people being confused and more confused than black people, non-white people, about racism. I don't understand how she's not seeing that. I don't know if she's just lying or what. And the last thing is, just as a human being, and knowing that the quote unquote people you classify yourself with have done these horrible things for centuries globally, and now you're studying one of these situations, many of these situations that go on in the U.S., you don't have any kind of remorse or feel a little bit disgusted about being classified with that group? I just I don't know. I'm just thinking that that's something that if you're researching something like this, it should draw a huge amount of disgust. I mean, people taking bones and body parts as souvenirs, and this doesn't draw any kind of resentment towards your own. I don't know. She's definitely an interesting person to speak to, and I wish we had more time to ask her some more questions, but I greatly appreciate her time, and it was definitely a good show. Thank you, Gus. I'll mute my line.
Much obliged, good sir. Other folks who... She's practicing racism. It's not that she didn't quote-unquote see it. She didn't have her blinders on. That's practicing racism. Other folks who dialed in, who had questions, observations?
Lydia.
Greetings, Ivy.
Greetings, Seth. Greetings to all the callers on the line. Yeah, she was a typical racist. Like, she played dumb. Talking about she was inarticulate and all this and that, and shout out to him on DC. You did an excellent job, as did everyone. As did you, Gus. And she, you know, she also tried that tactic where she tried to get victims to answer questions and tried to, you know, pick our brains and try to see, well, y'all brains, really, because I wasn't talking to her, to try to see, you know, what y'all was thinking. And she really tried to, she really, really wanted to push this lie. Glad you kept saying white people lie. Because as you kept saying that, I was thinking that with the ignorance that she tried to play and some other things. But she was really trying to push this narrative and this lie about white people being ignorant so much. So she was so passionate about that, you know, and you shut her down. She was so passionate about that she was trying to bully you and interrupt you on that. She did not want you to keep on stressing that white people are not ignorant. And she really had that agenda. And that's a real indicator right there when white people are passionate about just this idea that white people are ignorant. You can really tell a racist from that. But the first thing that you can tell a racist from is just when they classify themselves as white. Because it goes back to what you always say, what does it mean to be white? It's not biological. You're only white for one reason, and that's to practice racism. So I'm glad that you always ask the terrorists, like, if they're white. And that's all I can think of right now. Great program. I'll mute my line. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Gus.
Much obliged to Ivy. White ignorance that came up with Azure Savage this past Thursday. She wrote me back, man. She wrote me back. I can say really quick, this has nothing to do with what we talked about today. But she wrote me back. She should be on the program, I think, December 1st. A little ways from now, we can prepare. But she wrote me back. I told you when I was at the book signing, she said she already knew the cows. Okay. We've been on for 10 years. Okay. And so I wrote her to see about coming on the program. And she says, oh, yeah, we can do December 1st. She said, I heard you on the program talking about the event, and I liked what you said. I said, oh, my Lord, I'm glad I wasn't name calling, acting crazy, which is another reason why you should, you know, always prepare and speak as though everybody is listening. But I am looking forward to having her on the program. I was super impressed about a 16-year-old having a book written about racism, using the term white supremacy. And then she has a white parent on top of all the rest of it. Like, oh, wow. Will be lots to analyze. December 1, Azure Savage. I'll see if she has audio from the book signing so we can hear when my question was asked. Any other folks have questions, observations?
Gus, really quick, was Azure born a boy?
We will have to investigate. She, as I said, she identifies as transgender. So I'm not sure if she was born with the designation male and now has switched, but we can ask. We can ask, you know, break it down. I'm sure she would be willing to chat. And some of that might be in the book, too. So, you know, I will have read by December 1, I'll have read. So we'll have to see what's in the book. And then if it's not there, we can ask.
You can tell by looking, like, if she says she a transgender, if, like, if that means she switched to a boy or a girl or a man or a woman or whatever.
I'm using she pronoun. I think she may have as well. I might be in error. So I thought she presented as female. It's possible she could have been born a male. I don't claim to be an expert on that. 16 seems kind of young to have already gone through anything, you know, extensive. So, I thought she presented as female. We'll have to interrogate.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Can I be heard?
Thomas in New York.
Yes. So I've been trying to find a way to put the welding theory into play in my question, which is why I asked the annihilation without saying it, you know, that way. But it doesn't seem like people want to really engage that question too much. So very good show. Have my daughter listening. She listens in. Not sure if she's still listening or not, but you know, I thought that she was definitely practicing white supremacy. She wasn't that refined. She probably wasn't expecting this type of question, and I think she wanted to keep saying, "Well, what does this have to do with my book?" You know, but you know, your book is about white supremacy, so I don't understand why the question. You know, would lead to such confusion all of a sudden. The racial jokes, we never get a good racist joke. I don't even ask that one anymore because I know they're coded. They're never going to reveal that. One of the incidents is I was trying to chime back on Saturday. My daughter told me was about on the campus, white students approached the black students, very few black students, and wanted to cite them for having white paint on their face. I guess they were dressed up like ghosts or whatever for Halloween, and they wanted to know how come, you know, that's not considered racism, and if they put on blackface, it was considered racism, and you know, this turned into like a big thing on the campus where I think even the dean had to get involved. And, you know, she was very angry about that. And I said, you know, you always get in the question lane. So I told her next time that if that ever happens, you know, first you would ask them, do they want to wear black feet? You know, that's something they want to do. And, you know, wait for their answer. And, ask them, does white people put on white feet on their face for Halloween, you know, which would probably be yes. You know, do black people wear blackface? You know, which would probably be no. And I said, you know, that thing must be the end of it. You know, she said, wow. But, question lane, so I'm glad she was able to listen. I'm here, my mom.
Love it. Get question white people. That is the biggest thing. And don't help them with the answer. Ask your question and silence. Let them in, and then just pay attention. You might have to ask another question because sometimes they'll lie. I think we got some of that tonight. Or often they won't even answer your question. That's why I said you can't help them with the answer because that just plays into their strategy. If they're trying not to answer the question and then you hop in to help out or share whatever, they're like, oh, great, I didn't want to talk anyway. Whew. Thank you. Hopefully you'll forget about it and move on to a new question. You got to get, come back. Wait a minute. We didn't even get an answer. Questions don't help with the answer, and make sure they answer your question. If you have to ask again, like, you know, and you can, I might not, maybe I just didn't hear you. If you could, you know, repeat it again, make sure that I got what your answer was to the question, because I think I missed it. There you go. And if you need to, sometimes you'll have to ask repeatedly, because they'll just lie and continue to talk and talk and talk and bring up things where they don't answer your question. She did that the first time with the delectable Negro. She just went to the white guy who had the tooth and talking about him personally, not answering why do white people collectively do this? And then it got inarticulate. Any other folks have comments, observations?
Oh, one more thing.
Yes.
I was just going to say, if someone who said, you know, she doesn't get scared when she's looking up this stuff, you kind of pointed to it in your conversation. I think that when white people write these several detailed books about the torture that they put black people through, they get a pass, you know, because this is great reading for them. They love, this is better than watching television to them, to get several detailed information on how they tortured us. So I think that's why they get a pass.
Delectable Negro, retired firefighter?
Yes. As everyone heard, she used the term fair twice in my questioning. And what I think it was racist code for in this particular context, as a white person, she expects the idea in mind that white people cannot be trusted under the global system of racism. Their intent is almost never, well, never predicated on correctness. The idea in mind, they accept the idea that they're going to get challenged because they are truly understand that they are not very sincere about it. In her case, she is just one of the refined white people on that subject matter. That was just my observation of her coming up with the word, that's fair, that's fair. She said it in two different occasions when I was asking her questions, or based on my questions that I asked. Yeah.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. I think she slipped in about three fares in total on the broadcast. Did any other folks, observations, questions, comments?
I thought it was important when you asked her, like, why she wrote the book instead of helping a black person to do that, because many people on the broadcast, many of the callers and you tend to point that out. I think that's a very important thing. And white people, they're never interested in that. And it reminds me of, I believe you brought it up, but it could have been someone else. I think you did, though, said a long time ago that Mr. Fuller said that it actually could have been Mottiwick, it could have been him who said that Mr. Fuller said that white people are very good at putting themselves on all sides of the argument. So it's like they, you know, they're the perpetrators of lynchings, and then when they happen, they are the people who speak about them, who write about them, and they become the voice of lynchings. And they become pretty much the authority on how it's going to be talked about, how it's going to be thought about. And I want to somewhat retract what I said in terms of when I said everybody did a great job. I feel like I kind of came off as though I'm some sort of standard, like where I can, you know, measure whether people are doing a good job or not. What I meant by that is just that I learned a lot from what everybody was saying. And I tend to just regularly from the callers and from Gus. So that's just what I meant, that I thought that everyone's questions and comments were very informative to me personally. And I'll mute my line.
Much obliged. Ivy, all the folks who dialed in, always great to sharpen our skills questioning whites. Always enjoy having them on the program. We're looking forward to having more white people on as soon as possible. In the meantime, the book club is Thursday. Paul Robeson, The Artist is Revolutionary, authored by Dr. Gerald Horn, Black professor, University of Houston. We'll pick that up. Walter White will probably be mentioned on Thursday. We were just talking about him last week and his work in relationship with Mr. Robeson, and whoop, right in the middle of this here book, too. But the book club, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, back to normal time. No running around Seattle to engage in other activities. Incidentally, since Gus T is no longer a Neanderthal, like everybody else with a cell phone, I was able to activate my Cash App account. I thought it was activated before, but you have to have a phone to activate the account. So it is truthfully, like for real, activated now. Since I do have my phone, feel free to use cash.app/$thecows. Fully operational. I was so disgruntled. It wouldn't, people that had tried to send funds before and it wouldn't allow, because I didn't have a, they make you have a phone to use the account. If you attempted to use Cash App before the last 10 days or so to invest in the cows, it failed. So if you still have your Cash App and would like to support or tried to do so previously, you can try again. It should be working. No longer a Neanderthal, anachronistic cell phone like everybody else, all the other five-year-olds in the 21st century. Thursday, book club. Friday, neutralizing workplace racism. Saturday, the compensatory call-in. You can check Black Talk Radio Network and the Facebook page to see if there are other dates, times, trying to schedule and get some other authors on the program as well. Woo! The system of white supremacy. What a challenge. I will assume folks are good for the evening. Reading is more important than watching television. If you are in the Georgia area, you should. I'm not going to say that you have to read this book. I'm sure you'd probably learn some things, but you should know about the event. If you reside in Georgia, yeah, you probably should. Even though it's written by a white person, state history, local history, you shouldn't be a black person who is a Georgia resident or someone who was born in Georgia and be like poorly informed about this event. Like you should be like a scholar. If you have a child or family member and they're like, Morris Ford Lynching, what is that? Oh, yeah. Bang. Got that. Sit down. Boom, boom, boom. All the details. I know everybody's names. 1946 July. Boom, boom. Government Talmadge. Like, boom, boom, boom. I got all this. Got it. Like, I got it. A-plus counter-racist telling of what happened with this event. References where you can follow up, get additional details. You can make a whole library trip out of it. Or we can go see the plaque and all of that, but lots of ways where you can teach about white supremacy, racism locally, nationally, globally. With that,
just ask a question. Sorry.
She said she has a question. Ivy's question.
Man, Gus, like, my question is, how are you so courteous to these people? Because the more I learn about white people and the more I get mistreated by them, the more I hate them. And so the way that you talk to them, like you just don't seem to have anything personal against them, like the when you talk to them. In the same way, like with Mr. Fuller too, when he talks to white people, and in my observation, black men are mistreated more than anyone on the planet. So if I can't stand these people because of the way that I'm treated, I can only imagine you know what I mean, in terms of the way that you are treated. So how are you able to just, and it seems like it's more than just, oh, you have to do that for the program to survive. It just seems to be more than that. So that's just my question, is just how do you do that?
I just try to think out of it as business, like trying to be effective with the business of counter-racism, like really embodying what Mr. Fuller says. It's not personal, because it's not, you know. I think I pointed out where I felt Ms. Wexler wasn't being honest or was practicing racism. It's not personal. In fact, I'd be surprised if she didn't do it. And I mean, some of that just comes down to having correct expectations of individuals classified as white. But I mean, it's not personal. I think I've done that many times. And at least in my view, I found it's not effective. White people are very good at dealing with emotional victims of racism. If you're riled up and, you know, whatever it is, and being emotional with them, they can handle it. Sometimes they just get into, that'll become consumption sometimes. Just having a black person who is fuming and upset and going off and all that. Like, oh, yeah, that's right. Like, I've seen that before. What I've seen consistently, what they do not like, what takes all the fun out of practicing racism, no more coon joke time, it's just being logical. Being logical, being calm. You're not jumping up and down, just following logic calmly. That's when I've seen where it's, oh, man, we are not going to get to have fun on the plantation today. That's what I've seen. Not that they run in fear or anything like that, but it is a very different, like the caller who said, Ms. Wexler is probably accustomed to coming on programs or talking to black people where she's praised that, oh, you wrote this book and you sweet honey child, you lamb, you bless your heart. That's not the case. Like, whoa, what is these niggas? That's what I've seen consistently. Just being calm, that is substantially more effective than, you know, being emotional or taking it personal in any way, regardless of how you've been terrorized and abused, regardless of how justified your rage would be. Following logic, calmly, methodically, that would be the word I would use. Methodically, following logic. That's what I've seen. Is a problem potentially for whites.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. With that, and yoga, that probably helps too. Doing a little bit of yoga, that's my plan right now. Yoga mat is right in front of me. Can't practice with white people because that will mess that up, but do a little yoga. Help calm. Get some breathing in. Do my breathing too. Do my breathing exercises so I can stay calm. Get more oxygen to your brain. I think that helps on so many fronts. Help you stay calm. Helps your brain computer function at an optimal level. Win-win. Anywho, Thursday, book club, Paul Robeson session part 4. Moving briskly. With that, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. There was quite a bit of drinking in the book. In fact, Roger Malcolm, the black male who stabbed this white man, they said he was drunk at the time of the stabbing. It may have been that, you know, this suspected racist was sexually sewering his black partner, but alcohol was a contributing factor. Sobriety would be best. Let's go about the business of solving the problem. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled up every time we are in a vehicle, passenger or driver. Let's do all that we can to remain as safe as we can under conditions of white supremacy. If you're driving, never on the cell phone. Again, just doing the little things that we can do to try to stay safe under conditions designed to have black people in danger. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves, remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of Black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another Black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Man, I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.